some changes made. I can't keep on doing what I've been doing these days. Better figure out something, things are looking great. Are gonna be some changes made.
So last week we talked about, I kind of shared a little bit of the story of Blockbuster Netflix and how Blockbuster had this opportunity that they didn't even recognize in by early in the year 2000 or so, when Netflix executives flew in and they said, we have this idea, and Blockbuster said, no thanks, we know what we're doing, we're going to be fine, and kind of laughed them out of the room and said no to a partnership that could have saved their business. And we talked about how we look back at that and say they had an opportunity for change that was necessary and they missed it. And of course, Blockbuster is out of business. Netflix is thriving $150 billion company. What we didn't talk about though is the second chance that they had. Because most of us, when we get an opportunity for change and we look back and say, man, I really blew it, hopefully when we get a second chance to get it right and to make a right decision, we'll get it right the second time. And they had a second chance about 4 years later after that famous meeting with folks in Blockbuster. And the CEO, kind of looking and recognizing that Netflix had a good thing going, they said, well, you know, we have an edge on Netflix. That folks who have Netflix subscription, when they're done watching their movie, they have to wait a few days till the next one arrives in the mail. We could one-up them a little bit because we have retail locations. And so we can make a subscription that they get in the mail, and if they don't want to wait, they can return it to the store and get one from the store. And so they kind of rolled out a subscription good online platform, and we're starting to do pretty well with that. The problem is, the cost to roll that out was just about an easy $200 million or so, which is a significant investment. But it started to work okay. Well, they were still kind of fighting this issue of late fees, right? Because Netflix could still say that they loved their customers and they valued their customers so much they never charged them late fees, as opposed to those guys with the stores who charge their loyal customers late fees. And so the CEO made a bold move. And he said, we can compete with that. And they canceled all their late fees. The problem was that cost them another $200 million. And when investors really want your company to make a lot of money and you spend or lose upwards of $400 million, they don't like it too well. And so we look and see that, well, they kind of made some kind of good decisions, but the backstory that was happening at the same time, we say, why didn't they survive? Well, one of the investors who owned a lot of stock in the company got involved and got one of the executives to pull some moves with him, got himself on the board, and fired the CEO for those decisions. And a couple of years later, the company filed bankruptcy. And we look back and see they had a second chance to make some necessary changes. But again, they said, we know what we're doing. We don't like the future. We really like the past the way it was. No to change. We're just not ready for change. Because if we're honest, we'll admit, most of us do not change until we are forced to change. And even then, we really don't like it. Or as one of my favorite preachers says it, most of us do not change until the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of changing. Unfortunately for this company, pain of changing meant going out of business. And so let's talk one more time about change. We're going to acknowledge again that we don't like change. As much as we say that it's good for us, I mean, we started off the conversation, and we're going to kind of go back to where we started, saying that what if we were just to choose to believe that change is good? Why? Because growth is good, and I want to grow to be the man God wants me to be, and 1 year from now, I want to be the man God wants me to be then, but if I do not grow, if I say no to all change, then 1 year from now, I will not be the man God wants me to be then, because God wants us to grow, and growth is good, but growth requires change. And so because I want to grow, and because growth requires change, change is good. I'll just choose to believe it, in spite of how I feel sometimes. So this week, got an email from my mom that my grandma's house house in St. Paul, Minnesota, had sold recently. So I had some great, great memories. And one of the blessings of my early childhood was that Grandma and Grandpa were only 5 blocks away and that I could walk to Grandma's house. And I had some great times at Grandma's. I remember meal times and extended family and celebrations. And Father's Day would often include going to Grandma's house, and we'd all sit around her big table in the living room. And she was close enough, and I could watch, and she would babysit a lot, and I would hang out with her. And I just loved going to Grandma's, and Grandma taught me what she knew. Grandma knew how to sew, and so I remember sitting at Grandma's sewing room in the living room, and she taught me what she knew. I remember baking cookies and cakes and other things with Grandma in her kitchen because that's what Grandma knew, and she just shared her life and her skills and with me, and I just loved hanging out with Grandma. I loved digging around in the basement to see what treasures Grandma had long forgotten about. It was my first lawn mowing jobs as a 7-year-old could get paid to mow the lawn because she had like the real style lawnmower, and so it didn't require operating any, gas-operated machinery and all that, and so I loved hanging out with Grandma, and I cherish these wonderful memories of Grandma's house. So this week I got an email. It says, Grandma's house, they recently sold it again. And, for the last, Grandma and Grandpa moved out of that house when I was about 10 years old. And so for the last 30 years, I've had to drive by and look at the outside, which has remained the same, even the same painted yellow bricks, but haven't been inside and wondered, it's changed hands several times. What have they done? How have they improved the place? And just wondering. And so now I could get online and they say, hey, you should go online, look up the realtor listing and see the pictures and see what they've done with Grandma's house. And so I'm excited. And I look. Can you believe somebody had the audacity to remove that awesome brown paneling that was on all the walls in the living room? Seriously, they totally ruined Grandma's house. I looked at all the pictures, and I'm like, oh man, that nice little stylish purple color, you ruined Grandma's house. The only thing that is left of Grandma's house is the old iron radiators still in every room. But I have to admit though, like if I was buying a house and if I was looking, I would love it. Because it really does look great from like 2018 perspective. But in my memories, I wanted Grandma's house always to look and feel and smell and everything just like I didn't want change. So we need to talk about change because we know it's good for us even though we naturally resist it. So we're going to kind of go back to the personal element of change, and here's how we're going to conclude this time, this series. And our intent here is just to get us start thinking about some like change, church change, and other things, but really to look at ourselves and to make it personal. And so let's bring it back to that personal element today. One of the best quotes I found in some of the research about change is this one here, that people don't resist change, they resist being changed. See, the reality is you don't mind all the changes in the world until it affects you. You don't mind how they change streets and street signs, and you don't care whether they put up stoplights anywhere until they put up a stoplight on your route. And now that street you just used to fly right by, now you have to stop every now and then. We don't really resist change, we resist being changed. And when somebody tries to force a change on us, that is when we dig in our heels, because change hurts, especially when it gets personal. Leo Tolstoy has another great quote with this issue of change. Everyone thinks of changing the world, but no one thinks of changing himself. You could think of really great ways that all the people around you need to change and how the world around us needs to change or change back or change to or whatever to be a better place. Rarely do we look in the mirror and say, what needs to change here? That's what we're going to talk about. Because, as we said, we want to grow to be the men and women God wants us to be. And to do that, we've got to make sure we change in the right direction. And then one of the reasons this is difficult is because with so much of like culture around us changing, there is a degree to which we have to stand firm and not be changed in the wrong direction. Because every day we are faced with plenty of marketing messages that would encourage us to think differently, to feel differently, to buy differently. Plenty of messages, cultural messages, and not just like, you know, stuff to buy, but plenty of messages that would like to push us in the wrong direction, that would push us away from God and how we think and how we act and how we decide and how we view the world. And there's an extent to where we've got to stand firm and not be changed by the world around us away from Christ. But as we're going to see today, it's not enough to merely stand firm and not be changed away from Christ. We also have to be changed in the direction toward Him. In the Bible, there is a very short little letter to some Christians who needed to hear this message. So take your Bibles, if you have them, turn to the book of Revelation. It's easy to find because it's the very last book of the Bible. As we've mentioned a few times, you know, the books of the Bible are not really like books, especially in the New Testament. Rarely did these guys sit down and say, I'm going to write a book. They heard something. They were moved by God. Most of them are just simply letters or messages. And indeed, that's what the book of Revelation is. It's a message to seven churches that existed and in what is now modern day country of Turkey. And, you know, a lot of times we think of the book of Revelation, and we think of kind of these heavenly images and these beasts and other creatures that are interesting and try to describe. And of course, we think of these epic battles between good and evil. But the reality is, the book of Revelation, what we have to know when we start off is it wasn't originally written for you and me. It was written to these seven churches. And so the starting point of understanding the book of Revelation is like, what does it mean to them? So Revelation chapter 1, verse 19, we kind of get a little bit of picture of what's happening. It's in red. This is the words of Jesus. He's speaking to John, and he says, write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. And so he has a vision. That's why we call it Revelation. By the way, you always refer to the book of Revelation as Revelation. There's no S on the end of it, so just a little bit of extra trivia there that'll help you sound smarter. Anyways, so John has this revelation of what he sees, and then Jesus says, write it down what you have seen, and then share it. And these are things that are going to happen now, and there's some things that are going to happen later. And he says, then share this message with these seven churches. Here's one of the seven churches. It's Revelation chapter 2 is where we're going to look at. And look at what Jesus says to this first of the churches. To the angel of the church of Ephesus, write, here's the message, to the church in Ephesus, a town, kind of a major leading city in the Roman Empire. These are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, and who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds. Now we're going to come back to it, but first of all, don't get weirded out by, like, you know, seven lampstands, seven stars in his hand. If we read a little bit earlier, we discover that these seven stars, the stars represent like the angels or the messengers who God has authorized to speak to and to lead to these seven churches. And so he's holding in his hand these angels or messengers, and the seven gold lampstands represent these seven churches that he's talking about here. And the image here is that Jesus is kind of meandering and is around these seven churches. And so he's going to speak first of all to the church in Ephesus. And look what he says. The first thing he says, I know your deeds. In other words, Jesus says, I've been paying attention to how you all live together, how you worship, how you study, how you disciple each other. And if Jesus is going to say, I know your deeds, I mean, if he watches and lives among us and pays attention, then he cares. He cares, like, about what we believe. He cares about how we treat each other. This is a message to a church. We are a church, and so we would be wise to listen to what Jesus says to this church, but if he cares, because if he cares how these guys operate and we get directly the words of Jesus to a church, then we as another church ought to be wise to listen. That is how it directly applies to us. That's what we're going to hear today, is this message from Ephesus. And maybe you're not like, see yourself as a church leader, maybe you're not on the church board or whatever, but if you're a Christian, like, you're a part of the church. And how you act, how you speak, It matters that we are representative of Jesus. Maybe today, if you're not here, if you're here, but you wouldn't yet call yourself a Christian, haven't yet crossed the line of faith and proclaimed that you believe in and you are trusting in Jesus, but then likely you're asking yourself, is this local group of so-called Christ followers, are they actually faithful to the God they claim to follow? That's one of the questions you should be asking. And that is one of the questions we need to be asking. And that's a good question to ask. And so, again, you're kind of maybe checking some things out today, wondering what God might like to do in your life. We're going to kind of pull back the curtain a little bit and see, we're going to hear from Jesus how we as a church should be operating, and then we're going to get very, very personal with it. Jesus says to the church, I know your deeds. In other words, he cares. So what does Jesus want from us? And the rest of Scripture we find, and here's what we're going to hear as well, he wants us to be faithful. He wants us to be faithful in our allegiance to him, that we have proclaimed that he is Lord. In other words, he is ruler and leader in our lives, individually, in our families, and as a church. And so Jesus wants to see that we are being faithful. Are we faithful to obey him and what he says in our daily lives and how we operate as a church? Are we faithful in our times of worship? Jesus wants us to be faithful in how we are we being a faithful witness to the world? In other words, when the world sees Ridgefield Church of the Nazarene, do they see the face, the mind, the person of Jesus at work? Do we live, talk, operate, bless the world around us as Jesus would? Are we faithful witnesses? And you as well. When you're at work, doing your job, are you faithful to the witness of Jesus? How you talk, how you treat people, the jokes you tell around the water cooler. Are you a faithful example of Jesus? Because we see it matters. Jesus wants us to be faithful. Jesus also wants us to be fruitful. In other words, he wants us to get going and be busy about the work of Jesus, helping everybody around the world, in our own city and around the world, more people to love him, to know him, and to serve him. That's why we're doing Vacation Bible School. That's why we pour so much work and emphasis into it. Because we believe that even at a young age, kids can follow Jesus. So the first thing Jesus says is, I know your deeds. Are you being faithful? Are you being fruitful? Now let's look at the specific message that he had to this church. There's something we can learn here, even though our situation isn't exactly the same. So start again in verse 2. I know your deeds, your hard work, your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, and that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and that you have found them false. I know that you have persevered and that you have endured hardships for my name and you have not grown weary. See, the first thing he says in all these letters to these seven churches is he builds them up. He says, here's what you're doing right. And he gives them some words of affirmation. And for sure, these guys needed some affirmation. The book of Revelation was most likely, scholars think, written about AD 90 or so. And at that time, it was not popular to be a Christian in the Roman Empire. That political things that were happening, cultural things that were happening, quite often the Christians were being blamed unfairly for many of the things that were happening in society. And there was some persecution around. And indeed, even as we read in some of the other letters, that some of these followers of Jesus had lost their lives because of their faithfulness to Christ. They were persecuted to the point of death. Persecution isn't always something that happens to the point of death. If they were being persecuted that far, then there were some folks who were, they're being fired. Their employer was asking, was demanding that they do things that for them would have been a compromise to their faith, and they said no, and the boss said, then find another job. And out of faithfulness to Christ, they lose their jobs. And they're trying to feed their family. That no doubt there were lawsuits against Christians who were trying to just be faithful and obedient to the God they believed in, but the culture around them didn't like it, and they sued them and lost. Most likely there were professionals, maybe accountants, maybe teachers, maybe physicians, who were stripped of their professional licenses Because out of simple obedience and faithfulness to Jesus, they said, I can't and I won't make these compromises and do these things. The culture around them said, well, then too bad. Find another job. And what did they do? Let me look at it here. Jesus says, I know your deeds. I know your hard work and your perseverance. That you have hung in there and you have stayed strong and you've stayed faithful. I know your hard work, that you have labored and that you have given and that you have toiled and that you are tired. One of the stories we hear about the early Christians is a way that they were a faithful witness in their communities is that in their first century, infants and children were kind of at the bottom of the social, you know, social ladder of importance, and that infants were not always valued, and so regularly folks would have a baby, and if they felt they could not care for them, they would take the baby out, they would leave them at the city dump, and they would die of exposure. But the story goes that the followers of Jesus, they would go out at night, and they would find the babies that had been abandoned, they would take them home, and they would raise them as their own. Now that's a great witness. But that comes at a price. I mean, there's stress, there's a cost. To raise extra children that you didn't really plan for. And he says, you have, I know your hard work. I know your perseverance. I know what is costing you. And he says, good job. He says, I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles, but who are not. See, at the time when you know, they didn't have like the Bible and stories weren't like written down, formalized and said, this is the truth. There were a lot of preachers and teachers traveling around and traveling philosophers, and they would come in, and a lot of them, they were really good teachers, and they could sway a lot of people to believe their messages. And so they'd come into a church gathering and it sounded really good, and people would start agreeing with them, and the church leaders would say, wait a second. Now, I don't know that all of what you're saying really measures up to the truth of God. If you would say, yeah, it's great, it just feels so good, and they would get together and they'd say, okay, tell us exactly what you believe, and they'd pray about it, and they'd search the Old Testament scriptures, and they'd say, you know, what have we heard from all the teachers and apostles? And there were some times where they had to say, look, we hope your heart's in the right direction, or in the right place, but like what you're teaching is just not in line with the truth of God. You cannot teach this here. And a bunch of people say, yeah, but we love them and we believe in them and we're going to follow them, and there's problems within the church. And he says, you guys have done the hard work to like say we believe in the truth and we're going to stand firm in the truth, and we cannot tolerate false teachers, even if that means sometimes a break in fellowship and we've had to ask some people to leave because they insist on teaching stuff that's just not true. He says, you've persevered. And you have endured hardship for my name, and you have not grown weary. Good job. And he affirms them for this. Knowing a little bit of the backstory of the Ephesians here, like they're tough. There's a lot to admire here, that there is some like some mental and emotional toughness here, that they are sticking it out in the middle of tough circumstances. There's the problem that comes along with that, though. That when you are regularly faced with testing truth versus error, truth versus not truth, you can quickly become very black and white. And not everything is nice and easy black and white. And when you're faced with regularly having discern between truth and error, you can almost kind of get into this mood where you just start looking for it. And everywhere you go, you start looking for a conspiracy and you're looking for something that's not true. And that just becomes who you are. And your heart can be in the right place. But man, that's just like, it's not always a great place to be. See, there's a problem with like having this incredible mental toughness to endure intense persecution and endure intense hardship, is that while we admire the mental and emotional toughness that comes along with enduring persecution, the reality is the price you pay for that is a hard heart. That to be mentally tough often comes along with hardening over your heart, and you can't really feel as well, and you got to kind of shut down the emotions sometimes. Say, yeah, but Jason, look at what they've been through. And Jesus even says, good job, good job, good job. I mean, we need to like give these folks a pass. We don't expect them to be perfect, do we? surely we could give them some extra grace and say, it's all right if they're kind of a little bit hard-hearted and shut down their emotions here. Or is it? I don't know if you've seen the movie, but in 2014, the movie Unbroken came out, and it's the story of Louis Zamperini. He was a young man, he was a runner, and he ran in the Olympics, and then World War II came, and he was drafted to serve in the armed forces and to fight in World War II, and he was tough. He was, you know, the story is all about his mental toughness, but part of the story as it gets into the movie is that his plane is shot down over the ocean, and he and some of the guys in the plane, they get the life raft, and they survive. I think we have a picture of it here. Yeah, there. Remember that if you've seen the movie? Like, they survive for 47 days in the ocean. And I don't know if you've seen the movie, but I remember, like, when I saw the movie, when they finally, you know, it's well into the movie, and they finally are rescued, and you see, like, the ship, and I think they're even, like, sleeping or passed out something, and the show's, like, the shadow of a ship, and a bunch of sailors find them, and you're like, finally, the movie's over, because I'm pretty much mentally exhausted already at this point. Only to discover that the sailors are Japanese sailors who find them, and so then they send them to a prison camp. And the rest of the movie is, like, even more emotionally exhausting. I think we have just one of the scene. There you go. I took a little bit to find a scene that we could show in church. The rest of the movie shows how he endures terrible treatment and abuse in the prison camps, and he just has such a hard time with it. And he has for some reason the commander of the prison camp really takes it out on him, and he endures this extra abuse and treatment. And so by the end of the movie, you know, it, like, pretty much ends. And everybody's emotionally exhausted at that point, and he gets home, he kisses the American soil, he's glad to be home, and the movie just, like, quickly fast forwards to the end, and he's a hero. And for sure, he is. He's a hero. And he has endured, and he has hung in there, and he has undergone terrible treatment that you know, no one should have, and he's a hero. But I remember at the time a little bit of the controversy around it, and one of it said that it just kind of ignores a very difficult part of his life. The part that many soldiers face when they come home, and they're heroes for sure. And they've endured more, and he's endured more pain and suffering than anybody should endure, but he goes home and, well, he's got, you know, what we would now diagnose as post-traumatic stress syndrome. And he's struggling with being home, and he really struggles with alcohol and addictions and outbursts of anger. And it would be natural, like, our heart goes out to him and says, like, maybe he should just get a free pass because of all that he's endured, and he's a hero, and he's endured pain that no human should ever have to endure. Can't he just, like, get a free pass? But his wife and his kids, they're like, no, he doesn't get a free pass. He doesn't get to mistreat people just because of the pain he's been through. But we want to give him extra grace, and there's a struggle there. We just don't know how to handle that one. But our hearts go out, and we want to give him some extra grace for that and say, you know, maybe it's okay if he struggles to express his emotions. Look what he's been through. We don't expect him to be perfect, do we? So back to the story. Jesus, having affirmed the Ephesians for standing firm, enduring hardship, and not growing weary, look what he says in verse 4. Yet, I hold this against you. I do want you to change. I do want you to grow. I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. He says, let's go back and remember the time when you gave your life to Christ, Ephesians. And God came into your life, and he forgave you of your sins, and he forgave you of your past, and you recognized all the good things that God had done for you, and you worshiped him, and your heart was, like, overflowing with love to God. And you came to church, and you sang, and you celebrated. When you prayed, the tears ran quickly because it was just so fresh and new, and you loved God with all your heart. And you loved the people around you, and your love spilled over to those people around you. But then something happened. And the pain and the difficulty of persecution, you built a wall around your heart. And just to survive, you stopped up your emotions. And you're struggling to love. And God says, that's not okay. No one gets a free pass just because of you've been through a hard time. Now, he's not, like, condemning here. He doesn't just toss them out and say, you messed it up once, you're never going to get another chance. But he says, nobody gets a free pass. But, and then they could say, but God, we are standing for the truth. And God says, truth is not enough. You got to have love to go with it. You're doing well in the truth part. Now I want you to give some attention to the love part. But God, we are enduring. And he says, good. I wish more people would learn lessons of endurance. But I want gentleness to come along with it. And what you need to learn now is gentleness. But God, toughness. God says, toughness is good. Which a whole lot of other people need to learn about toughness and a soft heart. No one gets a free pass. The good news for Louis Zamperini is he came home from the war, he struggled, and part of his story that isn't highlighted in the movie is that he went to a Billy Graham crusade, and that God got a hold of his heart. And the God spoke tender words to his heart and said, come to me and let me change your life. And he gave his life to Jesus. He experienced the forgiveness of his sins. And he began to experience the change that God had brought about him. And God began to heal his heart and to heal his mind and heal his emotions. And the rest was a long, difficult journey, but he found sobriety and he found victory and he found healing and he found forgiveness in Jesus, eventually becoming an evangelist and sharing his story so that others could experience victory as well. And we look back and say, we're glad that God just didn't give him a free pass. But the God tenderly drew him back to God's heart and said, I've got something even more for you. And yes, you're tough. You've learned lessons of endurance. And yes, you're a hero. But even heroes get to keep growing. Even heroes need to be open to the change God wants in your heart. Even Ephesians who have grown strong and not grown weary and who have endured hardship need to be open to what God wants to do in their lives. Look at verse 5. Consider how far you have fallen. And they say, wait, we haven't fallen. We have stood firm in the truth. And he says, consider how far you've fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. Repent. Boy, there's a difficult word. Like, it literally means change. You're going in this direction. Repent, like, literally means turn around, go in that direction. You've been believing this. Change what you believe and believe this. That's like repentance. It's not just like a general, ooh, I feel sorry for how I treated people. That's part of it. It says, this is the way I've acted, and I recognize this is wrong. I'm going to change directions. Repentance is what God calls us to do so that he can change our heart and life and bring healing. Like we are not capable of bringing about every change that needs to happen in our life. So what God does is he invites us to change directions, to simply turn, and when we turn and go in his direction, then we open up our hearts for him to change us. So we talk about this word repentance, and usually when we followers of Jesus talk about repentance, we primarily think of it as like what a person does the moment they come to Christ. And so we say, yeah, I remember when and I followed Jesus and I repented of my sins and turned to Jesus. And we look back as like this thing we did in the past. Or if you've yet to follow Jesus and you're kind of thinking, praying, considering, like the big part of it is to come to a place of repentance, of turning. And we kind of view it as this one-time event. But look at Jesus is, he's talking here to a bunch of Jesus followers who have been faithful and they've stuck to the truth. And what does he want them to do? His one thing he says to them is repent. Do the things you used to do. Could it be that repentance is not just a one-time act, but that God is calling existing, lifelong, faithful followers of Jesus to continue to repent? And that anytime God points out some remaining sin in your life, that his call to you, repent, turn, come to me. That anytime God identifies a personal struggle that you're challenging and you're not doing so well in this little part of your life, that God's message to you is repent, turn to me, give it to me, let me bring about some change. What would it look like for you and I to buy into repentance for followers of Jesus? To say, God, not only does the world need so much change, but God, I need to be changed. And God, you know the places where I need some change in my life. I mean, I really think the world around us needs to see us Christians acknowledging that we don't have it all together. And I don't think we intend to portray that, but it is how we come across sometimes. And an attitude of humility would go a long way. For us Christians to acknowledge, I don't have it all together. In fact, I am pretty messed up. But I'm open to God changing me. And I'm open to doing the hard work of making some change in my life. Jesus invites us to repent. I'm going to invite our worship team to come on back. Here's how we're going to end our time today. We have saved some time here at the end to just sit quietly before God and seek him and pray. I know that like our normal tendency is we come, we pray, we sing the last song, and we're started to head out here, but let's just kind of resist that urge and just take a little bit of time to sit before God today. One of the ways that I think about this issue here is the way that God got my attention. Growing up in a Christian home and really giving my life to Christ at a young age, there came that time when I recognized that, you know, I wanted acceptance from friends and peers, and the way you did that at that time was to like say bad words and tell dirty jokes, and that got you acceptance among your peers, but I knew that wasn't right. And so I remember very clearly the time and the place that God really got my attention. It was at a summer youth camp. And the preacher was using this really great image. He said, you know, some of you, you're like a boat on a lake, and you're just like drifting wherever the wind takes you. And like in that moment, God was like, that's you, Jason. You're drifting. And his call to us was like, maybe today is the day to like drop your anchor and put your trust all your life in Christ alone. So that for me was like that life-changing moment I can look back to. And when I'm honest, I can see several points since then when God has said, you're drifting. But God, I've been working really hard to like stand for the truth. And he says, yep, and your heart's getting a little hard. And in that area, you're drifting. Maybe you find yourself like laughing at jokes you never thought you'd laugh at. And God says, you're drifting. Maybe you find yourself not hydrating, feeding yourself on the word of God like you committed to, and you were doing so well, but now you've become distracted, and God says, we're drifting. And the call is a call to repentance. The church in Ephesus, even in their attempt to remain faithful, they're unintentionally drifting, and Jesus calls them back. How about you? So, in these last few minutes, yes, we're going to sing a little bit. Let's seek him today. Let's seek him wherever you are, however you would like. Let's seek him today. Lord, speak what is true. God, thank you that you are a God of truth. And that even when your truth stings a little bit, Lord, we celebrate that you give second and third and fourth chances, that as long as we're here, Lord, that you're always drawing us to your heart. And Lord, I thank you today that you will always draw us closer and that you're drawing us closer even now. So Lord, we seek you today. Lord, however you have pointed out the truth in our lives, oh God, we want to surrender that to you. We want to surrender that area of our lives to you where you are inviting us to drift no more, but to turn in your direction. Oh God, we're yours today.